Face to face in secret places, feel the chill. Nightfall gathers me, but you know the plans I'm making to see overseas. Could it be the whole I thought could it be? The sacred wine for me shrinking in his eyes. The wicked wine until we dance into the fire. The fatal kiss is all we need. The fire, the fatal sounds of broken dreams. Dance into the fire. The fatal kiss is all we need. Dance into the fire. Choice for you is the view to wake you. Between the shades, assassination standing still. Earth with fell tears, the fall is no flakes on your body. First time in years to drench your skin, to lovers' rose insane. A chance to find the phoenix for the flame. A chance to die, but can we dash into the fire? The fatal kiss is all we need. Dash into the fire. The fatal sounds of broken dreams. Dance into the fire. The fatal kiss is all we need. Dash into the fire. When all the same, it's the will to a kill. When all we see, it's the will to a kill. When all we see.
Oh. Hello, everyone.
Joe
Lewis here, Battle Rankings Live. Welcome to another exciting episode. I am here with my lovely and talented producer, Anne. Say hi, Anne.
Hi, Anne.
And so today's show, we are going to be looking at line of sight. So,
a view to a kill.
Or a view to kill. Yep.
It was my last minute inspiration at work today.
Well, first of all, that was a cover. Obviously, we couldn't play. Yeah, because we can't play the original.
Yes.
You know, you go into various jails. So, who was the artist?
I think it's a gentleman from Italy who was. The trend is, of course, if you have a single artist, they do all the instruments and singing, and that's what he was. His name is Massimo Annibali. I think he is Italian.
He better be Italian with that name.
Massimo Annibali, and he played all the instruments, including adding the orchestra hit, which you know what an orchestra hit is, right?
Yeah.
It was one of the things from the 80s. Where did that come from? That was a
Duran Duran.
Well, no, the orchestra hit.
Oh, the orchestra hit?
No, it was from that. What was that tape-based instrument that where they could find sounds they liked? And what they did is they sampled the opening to the Firebird Suite by Stravinsky. And that's what that orchestra hit's from.
Oh, it's Moody Blues used it.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's the beginning of Strawberry Fields.
Yes.
It's a something Tron.
Something Tron. I'll figure it out.
Yeah.
But yeah. But anyway, so
Megatron.
That's where it came from. But yeah. But in the 80s, people like to use that sample that work. It's called the orchestra.
Bang.
Bang. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
It's a cool instrument. Basically, all the keys were basically you press the key and it rolled a tape, and so each key had its own tape and a tape head, and it had like I don't know like 27 yards of or 27 feet of tape.
Tape loops, yeah.
Yeah, tape loop, and then it to roll the tape, it would put pressure on a spin.
Mellotron.
Megatron? I was
no,
close to
Megatron. It's Megatron. M-E-L-L-O-T-R-O-N. Yeah. Everybody wants to look it up. Mellotron.
A Mellotron.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Beatles used it, a lot of people use. Now, that was not used by the guys in Duran Duran. They just happened to have, by this point, you had a synthesizer that had the same sound.
Computers just taking over.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Well, the Mellotron was essentially an early computer.
It was a computer.
An early synthesizer.
I thought it was just a tape, an overgrown tape machine.
Well, yeah, maybe.
Yeah, just tape, press a button. Yeah, by the way, if you thought there was an orchestra in your Moody Blues songs, wrong. It's a couple Mellotrons. You know, the guy's playing banks of them. You can, and there's a switch, and each tape had three things on it, and you can switch to them. And if you're really clever, you can actually put it between two and pick up both. Anyway, so enough about Mellotrons or Megatron.
Decepticons.
Yeah, anyway. What did Megatron's voice sound like? Was he like...
Megatron.
Was he like Skeletor? I thought Skeletor was...
Same as Skeletor?
Yeah, that's Skeletor, but no, I think...
I remember himself! Anyway, well, that's like Cobra Commander. Wait a minute. Is Cobra Cobra Commander Megatron and Skeletor?
Not Megatron.
What was the name of the guy at the aircraft? We're getting into Transformers
lore.
Trivia.
No, but I think they're all like separated from birth.
All right.
I don't know why I've never noticed that.
Starscream. That's what it was. Starscream.
Starscream. Yeah. Okay. All right. Enough of that. Why are we here? Starscream.
Someone else got it.
Yeah, Patrick. Yeah, unfortunately, there's a bit of a delay. From us, what we talk about here to you, which I'm gathering is about 5 to 10 seconds, which my little brain pie could fire a couple synapses between here and there. But anyway, I digress, which by the way should be a drinking thing every time I say I digress.
You're here to talk about sight lines.
Sight lines.
Or line of sight.
Line of sight. Yeah, sight lines.
Line of sight.
View to Kill. That's why we picked View to Kill. Which, by the way, was a James Bond.
Uh-huh.
Raymond.
Yep.
Trivia time. Mm-hmm. What was one of the best video games ever? Was it the View to the Kill James Bond game? For shooters?
GoldenEye 007.
Oh, it's GoldenEye.
On Nintendo 64.
I probably should have done some research before that instead of going off the cuff. Anyway.
It was the other one.
I digress. Okay, let's talk about why we're here. Actually, most important, let's get the housekeeping out of the way.
Yep.
Tournament's coming up. Yay, because that's what we're about. We're about you guys playing tournaments in places. I didn't have any tournaments this past weekend. Oh, but it's probably because of Mother's Day or something like that. You got your 15th Game Time Adventures. They're doing Late War. That's in Newark, Ohio. On the 22nd, you got three things going on. Family Time Games, that's where I'll be at. Mid-Ward, 90 points with a little asterisk. There's a thing about the 90 points, about how you build your force. On also the 22nd, Screaming Eagles, they're hosting a escalation late war, 75, 90, 105. That's three rounds. And Third Coast Games. Yeah, I think this, I'm gathering, this is a brand new store in Friendswood, Texas. And this is, I guess they're a brand new store, and this would be like one of their first games. They're doing a late war 100. And I think they're right outside of Houston. Then we jump to the 22nd. There's a DICON. On the 12th, they're doing it's a little mini con in Connersville, Illinois. They're doing a Team Yankee 105. And on the 13th, that Sunday, they're doing a late war 105. Then we jump down to June 19th and the 20th, Station Retro, which is in Huntsville, Alabama. They are doing a five-round, two-dayer, 105 D-Day theme. So it's a D, so from the D-Day books. And then on the 26th, this is where we're going to have our side tournament. And so family time. So let me digress. June 26th and 7th, that is Team Yankee Masters at Family Time Games. So I'm TOing that, which is really cool. I'm honored to be TOing it again. The, so that's set up. So let me tell you, first of all, by the way, I don't have any word on, Juan. You know what? I know I'm jumping all over the place. We'll just jump over to it. So here's the people that have accepted to be in this year's Team Yankee Masters. And so Chris Jackson, John Cederberg, John Meyer, Tom Burgess, David Vigor, Howard West, William Wright, Patrick Rice, Tim McClellan, Charlie Clay, J.B. Cederberg, Ryan Waldock, John Holland, Chris Fretz, Andrew Hobson, and Alex Big a Hammer Bottom. I don't know. I got to figure out how to say his name. Higa Baga Bottom. I'm sure he'll inform me next time he sees me. But anyway, these are the gentlemen that have accepted. There were two. There were two just that it couldn't make it. One was they're going to be moving into the brand new house, and the other one, his daughter was graduating, and that was that weekend of her graduation party from college. So that makes sense. So we only had to go to two alternates, so that works out. That's real good. Let me talk about the format. The format for Team Yankee Masters this year is, well, first of all, you can only use we're using the extended battle matrix. So the brand new one that they just came out last month, we're going to be using that. And you have to use each stance twice. So it's six rounds. You have to use two attack, two defend, and two maneuver, and whatever order or whatever combination you want, that's up to you. Obviously, you don't have, as you start using things, you don't have too many choices at the end. The format is this, you create a 70 point list, and, so just a regular, you know, list formation or formations, whatever you want, 70 points. Then you'll have, then you're going to create three more, we'll call them sidebar list, of 10, 20, and 30 points. And it only could be used for support or support formation. I don't know if you get a 10 points support formation, but you probably could with 30. And that will be added. So every round after the tables, the matches are set up and the tables are selected, randomly draw which one you'll be using. So you will play with the 10 pointers, two 10 pointers, two 20 pointers, and two 30 pointers. That will be random. So every time the battle is picked and the tables are set, or the matches are picked and the tables are set, randomly draw a B or C. So for 10, 20, and 30. And so you'll play with the 70 plus whatever the sidebar thing is. And then, you know, you pick your stance and you guys roll die and go for it on the chart, an extended chart. That is the format this year for Masters, Team Yankee Masters. So it provides a little bit of interesting. You could try to time it out. So like, hey, you know what? I want to be more defensive, but when my 30 point comes up, I'm going to build an offensive force. Well, that's fine. But guess what? Those plans, they tend to fall apart when you guys, when you run into the enemy or your next opponent. So it should be interesting to see how this plays out. A little bit of twist. Actually it should be fun. Now, why that is going on, that Saturday, we are going to have a side tournament, which is going to be, I can announce now, it's going to be, what is it going to be? Shoot, I was doing all this other stuff. There it is. It's going to be, it's going to be on Saturday. And it's going to three rounds. Oh, it's a de-escalation, mid-war de-escalation. We're going to start with 180, then go to 85 for the second round, 70 for the third round. The thing is that you need to have the same core formation book for all three. Long as you have the same formation and book, you know, from the same book for all three, that's the only thing you need to make it legit. The composition of each one is up to you for the amount of points. And that is what we're doing for Saturday. So if you were, you know, if one of your buddies is in the Team Yankee Masters and you want to travel with them, you have something to do on Sunday. More the merrier. So I got four people signed up and one out-of-towner so far. So it's pretty good just for something we just announced or we just announced what the format is. You could go to the Facebook Battle Rankings. I have a events up there that has all the details. You can read it. But if you want to travel out with one of your buddies, play in the side tournament, please do. It'd be good to have you. But you know what? I know what you're saying. Joe, that's a Saturday. What am I going to do Saturday evening? Oh, wait, I'll tell you. We go out to dinner and have an awards banquet. It's kind of an awards banquet. That is when the trophy for the year's tournament, for the points leader of the tournament year, gets his little trophy. So that's when we award that. But, of course, we go out dinner and have fun. But you're like, I know what you're saying. But Joe, that's a Saturday. What about Sunday? Well, let me tell you, we have something special lined up for Sunday. Now that is, we are going to do a live Battle Rankings live broadcast from the tournament. Standing around a little into the lunch hour for the tournament and during the whole fifth round on Sunday, we're going to be broadcasting. So that's about 2.5-3 hours of a planned show. We did one last year. We did announce it. We had a blast, but we're going to try to do something a little bit more. We want a live audience. We want you guys to come out. And we want you get to show your support. And what we'll do is we'll do interviews and talk to people in the crowd, in the audience. And we're going to set up a special place for Ghost Panzers fans. And we've given the Panzer, the Ghost Panzer fans name. And what's their nickname?
Panzer Pest.
Panzer Pest. So we're going to have a Panzer Pest pen where we're going to corral the Panzer Pest.
Do they exist though?
They do. Pests? Oh, they do. I get fan mail all the time.
You do not.
Oh, yeah. We had to hire an intern.
Why would I not get some fan mail?
I don't
understand. I am worthy of fan mail.
You are. Memphis, we had to hire an intern. To go through the mail.
Okay, so was there a Ray?
Yes. So
Ray, are you our intern?
Yeah. Yeah. He's family, so we don't have to pay him.
Okay. Ray is like cocking his head going, no, I need to be paid.
So yes, the Panzer
College.
Yeah. Panzer Pests. Yeah, well, basically, we are going to have, for our number one intern, we are going to have a college fund.
Oh, right.
Okay. Oh, Patrick says he thought Sherman was the intern. No, Sherman's just the Panzer Pest. Yes, so we're going to have our Panzer Pest, and we're gonna do a show, and we want you there. Now, by the way, we're also... I'm trying to work out the details and buy the equipment to actually broadcast or webcast one of the tables, all six games. So we'll have that on the side. We're gonna do better than we did with Team Yankee. So I'm looking for a better camera, a better rig, instead of just using a cell phone trying to capture it. I'm actually looking for overhead rig and the whole shot. So I'm working with the store about setting something up. So that should be, I hope I could pull that off. So that'd be really cool. Will the game broadcast be on Twitch? Sure. Actually we're going to do it. We'll do all three, Facebook, YouTube and Twitch. I'll actually see if anyone other than Brian Coaches actually watches on Twitch. We'll see. But that's what we're going to do. It'd be nice to have you guys come on out the end of June if you're nearby, travel or something like that. So if you do come out with your buddy and you want to participate, you do have 2 days of entertainment, which is the game, the first one. And the first day for a little tournament, you hang out with us on the banquet meal, and then the last day, which is the broadcast. So that should be fun. At least I hope. The Panzer Ghost will be there.
Yeah.
Oh, wouldn't miss it, right?
Not a goal.
Nope.
Nope.
Nope. All right.
Be there or be square.
Exactly. Just last piece. If you like what we're doing here and you like the show and the information that we're putting out for the hobby, subscribe, support, hit that like button. The more times you hit the thumbs up or the love button or whatever it is, the heart button, the logarithm will push this out to more people to actually play this hobby. So, yeah, you guys on there now, smash that button, as the youngsters say. Subscribe here, YouTube, whatever it is. Twitch, if you're somehow over there, that'd be awesome. Subscribe so that you will always get a notification. You make sure you hit the subscribe. and hit a notification bell if there is one, like for YouTube. Hit it. So that people, we can get this information out to people. Because we do it for the pure love of the hobby. Okie dokie. Yeah. Matter of fact, you know what? Yeah, you might want to come, you know, especially for the Panzer Pest. Do you know why? I heard that there will be a special edition tokens for stance tokens that are a limited edition Panzer Ghosts.
Really? You're making Panzer Ghosts fun?
Yeah, Panzer Ghosts, you know, with the attack, defend, and maneuver on the chip. Yeah.
You just have to say it with a German accent.
How do you say it?
Attack!
Attack! Attack! Schnell! I wonder what the attack in German is.
Maneuver.
Anyway, so yes, so you can get those if you come on out. So basically, dangling the carrot, limited edition. That's that guy from what's the stuff that used to sell? You watch TV and buy things. Has three letters to it anyway, but yeah, you go. Mark McGuire rookie card. So we have a limited edition Panzer Ghost stance selection tokens that are just for the audience members. So come on out. It should be exciting. All right. Anyway, let's get to the topic du jour. And how are we doing on that? Almost a half hour. Not too bad. Let's go and... we are going to talk about line of sight. And the thing about line of sight is that Angriff? I bet that's attack, I'm sure. Sounds like a German word. Except I thought it'd be four letters. It's just a German joke. Let's talk about the line of sight. One of the things about line of sight is that it's probably the thing that gets the most arguments, probably the second most arguments in a game. Can you see or not see the target? So one of the things, what I did here, you'll see where it says page numbers. The first number is actually in the Flames of War book. And the second number is in the Team Yankee book. So if you want to reference the where they're at. So I kind of gave them a little synopsis. When you're checking the line of sight from one figure to another, it's the weapon mount of the gun or tank team, or any part of an infantry base, or any part of the flight stand. And you trace that to any part of the tank hull that you can see, and part of the base of the infantry or gun team that you're shooting at, or any part of the flight stand. So that's checking line of sight. So that's interesting thing about the flight stand is that because it's the flight stand, which it's got a flight stand here. So when you're looking at the flight stand, there's the bomb. And I put a scenery on this flight stand. Actually, I probably should make that bigger so you guys can see it. Oh, yes, I misspelled it. Thank you. So that flight stand, that's the thing you draw your line of sight to. Thanks. I was typing. Oh, anyway, no excuses. I should have attention to detail. Matter of fact, you know what? Since you pointed it out. I can change hall on you guys. Anyway, so there it is. I'll change hall. Anyway. Silly me. I'll change it. So that's how you check your line of sight from the one point. So it's basically it's a turret or the gun itself, not part of the barrel. So I just happen to have an interesting 88 here. Oh, doing that to you guys again. Get it bigger. So there's the 88. So you'd actually check from the center of this gun to the target, right? Even though it spins 360, you would check from this point. Shooting at it, yeah, they say I should blame the intern for the haul. But I won't do that because he's a much better speller than I am. Much. So I take full responsibility. Okay, so that's where you would take that. Now, the interesting thing is when you're checking range, you check from the closest point of the tank hull, H-U-L-L, or the closest point on the infantry or the base on the infantry of the gun. So, back to this example. So even though I might measure the line of sight from here, but the range is actually from the base. So the range is from the base. So you have a, you know, especially from like, you know, here to here, which is about an inch. So even though this is back an inch, it's really, you'll be measuring from that location on the base. So it's a base to base. That's how you check the range. Or I like this one, the closest point on the fuselage. So that way a plane, oh, here we go, fuselage. So if you have a plane, it's not the popping back and forth here. So with our plane here in our stand, right, I would measure to the fuselage, not to the base for the range. And that means that, you know, some things, like if it's towards the rear, get a little bit closer than the base, especially a big honking plane like that. Those are interesting little tidbits. So then there's a couple things when you're measuring. You have to get, you know, always go through you're going to look at what terrain you pass through. So I wrote this thing called Mind the Gap. So between the short and tall terrain, because the idea is, you know, typically if when you're firing, you want to line up the best shots possible and you want to avoid terrain if you can. And they talk about a three-quarter inch gap. It just turns out that your measuring tape, the standard one from, say, like Gale Force 9, this is actually 3/4 of an inch right there. And a lot of tape measures are that size where it's 3/4 of an inch. Not all of them, but there's a bunch of them. So you could check if yours, by the way, when I was looking at this thing, I have, it's kind of interesting is that you can see where it's worn out in the side here. That's how many times I've opened and closed this thing. And I noticed that it's not worn out way out here. It's worn out from the little distances, which makes sense. Back to this. So the if you could put a 3-inch, that 3/4-inch gap between there, you get a clear shot. If it's under, you are going to get, you'll get concealment. Now, there's a certain point where you can actually see the unit, but there's sometimes you just can't, might see a fender. That's not really a line of sight. You might see the fender, you might see the rear of the vehicle, like a track, the rear track. That is a no-go shot. But more than that, you can get see it. Now, this thing is, we're keeping this to line of sight. I'm going to try to stay away from.
The cat's up there with your router.
Yeah.
I'm hoping he's not going to, like,
get down,
mess up something up there.
Stupid cat.
You're hardwired in, though, right?
Yeah.
Come here.
Yeah, actually, less than the 3/4 inches actually could block the line of sight. So you need to take a look. The rules, you know, stay. It's all about how much of the model you could see. But now we're getting in concealment. So I'm going to pop out of concealment. But talking about if you're going to see the model, you're going to look through there. Less than a 3/4 inch gap. Now you get into the point of maybe I don't have a shot at all. Aircraft, which is on page 52 or 40 in Team Yankee. Terrain never blocks to or from aircraft. Never blocks line of sight. Now, you might have concealment. That's something different story. Then I get to a section which I call the 2-inch rules. So if the edge of a short terrain or tall terrain, you were 2 inches, you could see all the way out, but you could be seen in. There's another one, which is by a window or a door of a building. So if you have infantry and you want to shoot out, you actually have to be within 2 inches of the door or window to shoot out. Likewise, to shoot at those, they need to be with 2 inches. So it's kind of like this. A building becomes a forest, and you have to, and it's a special, you know, think of it as just 2 inches of the door or window, which actually, if you're using Battlefront, is that cat just laying down like that?
Yeah, he's just like hanging over your chair.
What a lazy bum.
he's getting
a
cat.
True. The 2 inches from the door or window to shoot out. That's a neat thing in there. And you can find that on page 52. Smoke. All right. Smoke is one of those things that really confuse people because people treat it as it's a forest, which is 90% there for a forest. Windows are short terrain, so 2-rule is not correct. I'm going to show you. I have something coming up on that. The smoke in, out, or through is always concealed. And there's still the 6-inch rule about you could see 6 inches deep into it. Or 6 inch, you know, there's a 6-inch depth into the, well, it's not really a depth. There's the 6-inch rule, which I have an example coming up. But in, out, or through. Now, if you're in it and you're seeing out of it, the smoke, In a forest or you know, shorter or tall terrain, if you're shooting out and you're within 2 inches of that, you don't get a penalty. But with smoke, you do. Your spotter, which is on page 67 or 52 of the various rule books, line of sight to the aiming point. So you need to be able to see the aiming point. So there's that. Leadership. Here's another one that needs line of sight, which, you know, you didn't need before. But to get that reroll for morale or something like that, or some a lot of people that give special, you know, abilities or powers or whatever you want to call it, you need to be within line of sight and within 6 inches to provide that. Now, let's take a look at a couple things or look at one thing. So I want to talk about the 6-inch rule here. So if you are within 2 inches of the edge of the terrain, you could see infinity. You could see all the way out and everything could see you. But if you are back beyond the 2 inches, there's the 2 inches, there's the what I call the 6-inch rule. From the aggressor to the target, you need to be within 6 inches to see the target. As that target moves through, a little animation here, as it moves back, that 6 inches travels with it. So if you want, you know, if this is the case, Yeah. Oh, I'll get back to that, Malcolm. So right there, so you see that 6-inch, if you're back here, this item needs to would be within six, the tank would here would need to be with 6 inches of the infantry. So it's just not, that 6 inches moves between observer and target. Let me go here. Malcolm says, something that confuses me. So a spotter needs to see the aiming point, but not necessarily the target of the bombardment. That is correct. That is correct. You just need to see the aim point. And here's a good example. This template, the big size. Yeah, I did. You know, if I see the endpoint, like between two buildings, and I lay this top of a town, I don't need to see the back buildings or anything because the bomb, you know, the shells and stuff like that don't care who they're landing on. I just need to see that center point. And if I could put it right down in the center point, that's all that matters. And it's all about ranging in and rolling to hit. Okay. By the way, yeah, you guys, you feel like you have any questions, you know, go ahead and put it on there. All right. I am now going to, wow, look at that cat, man. He's a, yeah, just swing him out there a little bit more. Okay. All right. So, hey, no problem, Elkin. That's why we do a live so you can answer and ask the questions. So we can make sure that we're addressing, because this is stuff for you guys to help improve your game. It's why we're doing it. Let's talk about lessons of front. By the way, I just typed in the word line and searched for it. It's all over the place, but I feel that Sherman is lying there judging me. He is judging. He's like, humans, they must serve me. So we'll go here at the line sight. The first one I'm going to address, and by the way, I don't think this is the order they come in there, but I put this in the order I want to talk about them. It's hills and buildings. Do the general line of sight rules for tall terrain apply to hills and buildings? And so when the original rules, I must confess, when the original rules came out, I thought tall terrain was tall terrain and it went up to the infinite sky and you can't see over or through it or anything. And I thought, oh, I mean, that makes things a lot easier. You know, if I'm on a hill and I'm behind a building, you can't see me, right? Well, then a couple lessons the front came out and then that blown all away. I guess, you know, we're going to slide back from a simple rules to a more role-playing, more of a miniatures game, which is, that's what we're doing here. And the answer is no, the specific line of sight and concealment rules for hills cover the special cases for hills. You know, okay. Someone asked the question because they're a little confused and then says, hey, go read the rules. Well, my assumption is that before you asked me that you actually read the rules, and that's why you're asking. This is what comes out of all that. You go to a WYSIWYG scenario. So if you have a building and you have a hill, now that, by the way, that could be one honking big hill. All right. I mean, it's way up there and there's the building down here. So if you're on top of it and you do a line of sight, basically a WYSIWYG, and look, can you see that base? And just do it, you know, if you're doing left or right for between buildings, do it like you're just doing top. Do you see enough of that vehicle or infantry stand to be able to target it? What direct fire? That is basically what I'm just summing it up, what comes out of this. Another scenario, is that you basically three hills, hill one, two, and three. On hill one is opponent A, is player A. Opponent three is opponent B. All the hills, say for the purpose of this exercise, are battlefront hills. They're all the same size. If I was hauled down on the two, can I shoot? Can I shoot? And before, if you just kind of read it and said, oh, well, it's a hill, tall terrain, no. In the WYSIWYG world, yes, because the hills are all the same size. We don't have the effect of the curvature of the earth, so we don't have to worry about that. So because it's all the same size, they're on the same plane, they're hauled down. So you could shoot them, you could shoot at each other and get the plus one for concealment if they're both hauled down in that scenario. So there you go, WYSIWYG. For those who don't know, yeah, WYSIWYG is what you see is what you get. Kind of like me, would you say?
Yes.
Definitely. Yes. I'm a WYSIWYG guy. What you see is what you get.
I like the cat.
I like the cat, yeah.
Cat is WYSIWYG.
Sometimes I wonder if the cat's, plotting or something. I don't know.
No, he doesn't plot. This cat is not. No, he's not.
He's not a plotter. Okay. Anyway, so WYSIWYG is basically what you see is what you get. You draw. You take the line of sight. Which I wish that was better out there was, I have yet to see a good laser pointer that puts down a line that is for gaming. You know, the kind that you want to drop 20, maybe 20 bucks for. And point it at the table and get a line. Because the only good thing that does that is stuff that you use to hang pictures or drywall or chair railings or something like that. And those are $100, a couple hundred bucks, depending on what it is. I'm not going to draw a couple hundred bucks just to get myself something that draws a line on that laser line on the table. I kind of wish they had a good one for wargaming. Because after time, you just don't want to get down there and take a look, it gets a little hard to get back up. Butcher's thread. What is butcher's thread? Is that like the string?
It's like the string that you use to wrap around.
And then just go from one to the other.
Yes.
Well, that's a low tech solution. Mm-hmm. Okay, I like low-tech solutions. Low cost, too. Just go in the butcher shop. Give me a pound of string. Anyway, if you have the next one here that someone asked, if you have a team on a hill, a high hill, trying to shoot a team on the far side of a low building, can you do it? Now, this is kind of – these are two together, and they put this in there. The only way to answer is to get down to the level of the model and see the line of sight over the building to the opposing team. This is what we're just talking about. Once back, we're back to WYSIWYG. What you see is what you get. Draw that line. All right. Here's your window scenario, which, by the way, is probably one of the longest answers I've seen in a free, FAQ. A shooting team has line of sight to a window through a building containing several infantry teams. Which ones can I shoot at? You can't shoot through walls. Now, by the way, I find this is interesting. This is a wartime, and you can't shoot through walls. Talking about, weapon discipline, right? You can't see it. You can't identify it. Don't pull the trigger, right? Never shoot through a door. Never shoot through a wall.
Bad idea.
Okay. So you got to have some trigger discipline.
Yeah.
That cat has some trigger discipline. All right. So it says here, you can't shoot through walls. I guess you could, but you have trigger discipline. So all your troops have trigger discipline, even those silly Russians. So you need to see the target team through a door or a window to be able to hit it. The terrain table has a bit of an oddity where it says that doors and windows are short terrain, while the walls are tall terrain. It makes more sense to view the doors and windows as tall terrain too. I'm going to look back on the thread there. That means that you'll be able to see teams in the building that you have line of sight through a door or a window that's within 2 inches of the door or window. The converse applies for teams looking out of the building at your troops too. Yeah, boy, Rich, you got that one right. 50 cows don't care about your walls. Yep. That's an interesting thing about, yeah, hey, you know, that chart says one thing, but maybe you should think about it like this. Wet the whistle. So basically being 2 inches of a door or a window, which is interesting, is that if you are within 2 inches of door and window, that means you probably can have multiple teams shoot out. All right. We'll just leave that there. Oh, yeah. In Soviet Russian, walls shoot through you. Yeah. Okay. So this one I gave for reference. There's a couple points in the lessons from the front where this comes up a lot. And so I only put the question once, but the question, the little part changes. The command leadership role gives rerolls to a formation commander that is close enough and in line of sight. Do friendly teams block line of sight for command? No. Ignore friendly teams when determining line of sight. Now, you can't shoot through friendly teams, but you sure can look through them. And I had a lot of people look through me like, what are you doing? Then there was another one about movement orders and another one for spotting. So, no, friendly teams do not get in the way of line of sight. So there's a couple references to that. And in the answer is always the same. So they don't block line of sight. Now they block direct fire because your friendly teams don't particularly care for that. Chris here says, all teams 2 inches to the windows can fire out. Yep. That's basically that little middle section there. That's what it's telling me. Fire out. All right. So on my way home from work, from the office, I was thinking about this scenario. And I didn't have time to draw it up here. Okay, ready? I have a stone wall, a short terrain stone wall. On one side of the stone wall, that's an inch and a half away from the stone wall, is a couple infantry teams, all inch and a half away. On the other side of the stone wall, an inch and a half away, is the opposing players' infantry teams, a bunch of stands. If player A was going to shoot at player B, where the stone wall, so I got, you know, here's my stone wall, and I got infantry stands here and infantry stands here. They're both an inch and a half away from the stone wall. When A fires at B, now we establish line of sight, but this is the thing about concealment. Does team B get concealment from team A? Go ahead, post your replies in there. I already see one. Do 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 do. Mm-hmm. 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 Bum, 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 bum. I know there's a couple more of you guys. Put down your paintbrush and hit an answer. Uh-huh. 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 Yeah. So far, yeah. Waiting for the other replies to come through. Boom, ba boom, boom. You know what's pretty cool is that it's almost 9 and the sun's kind of, I can see the sun's still out there a little bit. So that's pretty cool. I like this time of year. Yeah, I like this time of year. All right, time's up. Yeah, Ashley, there's no concealment, which means there's no bulletproof. Because an episode I had a couple weeks ago, only way you can get concealment or bulletproof is if you get concealment from the bulletproof. Since you guys are close enough to the target, you don't get concealment, you don't get bulletproof. That is just an interesting way of just walking up to a wall, both sides, and blast away. And that wall doesn't, basically doesn't get touched at all. Anyway. Okay. So, yeah, I just throw that out there. Let me see what else I got going here. Okay. That is pretty much the things about line of sight. Now, I want to talk about one more thing about line of sight, which is not in the rules. But it's the gameplay now. I got a couple notes. Now, line of sight's really about shooting, but really, when you want to line up the line of sight, it actually happens. You should do it in the movement phase. So, as you move, you want to line up your line of sight. So, the rules as written, you move platoon by platoon, and then team by team in the platoon. So, you pick platoon A and then move, team 1, 2, 3, 4, and each time. That is the time, as you move, you're trying to line up your shot. You talk to your opponent, and you say, okay, I have movement up to here. Do I have a clear shot? And that's when you go back and forth about the, you have concealment, not concealment, shot, no shot. It's during the movement phase. You do not want to have the argument about if someone has a shot when you're about to roll dice. You want to do it through the movement phase, because if for some reason, you thought you're going to have a shot and you don't, you can at least move, do something else with your movement other than, hanging out there flopping in the breeze because you thought you had a shot and it was a good opportunity. So that is the point to actually line up your line of sight when you get during the movement phase. Let's see what else we're about here. Line of shot during the movement phase, line up your shots. Talk to your opponent. Yeah. The other thing too is, before the game begins, I was thinking about that. I actually should make a checklist of things that you should talk to your opponent with. You take a look and you talk about the terrain and how you're going to handle the terrain. Is this hedge tall? Is it is short? Which, by the way, there's a lot of. And the neat thing is that the book's pretty clear about it. And about with the listing of the terrain, I like to stick with what's in the book because it's the easiest. And then worry about there it is, on page 43 in the Flames of War book. And then try and get the railroad tracks so they're flat. You just can't dash over them. And I wonder if to talk to your opponent part gets tricky, etc. It probably does. Except, English is the tournament language, and also it probably, you point at something and you just say tall or short, your opponent who's there playing, they're kind of a hardcore player, because if they're doing you just don't go to ETC on a whim, right? It's probably, they can tell, hey, is it tall? Is it short? And they go, oh, short. And you could solve all that pretty easily there. I probably wouldn't have too hard communicating that, Like, oh, by the way, if you think they don't, you know, for us Americans, if you don't think they can understand English, just talk louder. Is this tall terrain? No. 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 Yeah. It's just because they maybe can't understand your English doesn't mean that they can't hear you. Anyway, so yeah, so you know, tall, short, you'll get through it. Actually, there's a couple people I have actually I've actually pulled out post-its and wrote down T or S and put little arrows and plopped them down on the battlefield so that everything that we talked about. Because past experience has told me that, you know, we agreed on one thing and, you know, and I just wanted to make sure it wasn't me. So I just put down the post-its. Here it is. Let's see here. I have a question about shooting through gaps. Are there any time you could shoot through a gap smaller than 3/4? I think you said on page 52, and I think that's the Flames of War book. Bear with me. Well, it says here, actually I should use the, whatchamacallit here. Gaps of less than 3/4 between two terrain pieces or a friendly team, other than a stationary infantry team, give concealment and block line of sight if any way that the terrain or team that any way the team or terrains do. Use a tape measure to guide whether the gap is wide enough to see through, and then that's where you get the 3/4-inch rule. If the gap is smaller, then you go to, can you see enough of the model? And that is, that's when you talk about, can I shoot that? Is there enough there? And you and your opponent can, you know, I can tell you one, sometimes there's no clear cut other than seeing it on the table. And that's where you have to do the WYSIWYG and do it at the time of movement, not the time of firing. Go, hey, this guy, I have enough movement to come here. Can I see that? Is that gap big enough? Now, by the way, this is what I do for terrain, so that because conversations like that actually take away from playing, is that I make sure there's an inch gap between my buildings and terrain pieces. So when I build a table, I always like to have that inch gap. Either it's an inch gap or no gap. Make it easier for the players. If I'm going to have two buildings, I'm going to butt them together. They are butt together, you know. No question. That way, because it all comes down to terrain and building your table. By building a table that holds to those things for a tournament, makes the playing go easier because the two players can look at it and say, yeah, that's an inch gap or no gap. Real simple. You move on, you're playing, you're rolling dice, and hopefully you can come to a conclusion for the game and have a good game. Other than sitting there, because there's nothing worse than going back and forth for 15 minutes going, yeah, I can see you. No, you can't. Yes, I can. You know, anything you can do, I can do better. Anything I can do better than you, that's your cue.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can.
No, you can't.
Yes, I can. Anyway, so do that as putting a table together. Now, if you're a player walking up to a table that is totally not this rule, talk to the other player and say, hey, let's straighten this table out. By the way, there's nothing wrong with it. Before you roll dice or pick anything, you guys – you know, clean up the table, especially at, you know, in rounds, the table stuff gets moved all the time. So it's easier. Hey, let's just fix this up. Hey, there's an inch gap here there, or there's no gap. And you just fix the table. There's, by the way, nothing wrong with that. Or some people play it like, or play it way the artist attended. Anyway. But yeah, straighten out the table. That, you know, that gives you more time to play than less time bickering, arguing about who can see who. Okay. Let's see here. You have agreed on different rules for terrain. For example, tracks give concealment because you consider them to be elevated. I've had that happen in a game before. Tracks give concealment. Oh, railroad tracks. Ah, okay. So, yeah, there are three things for railroad tracks. Let me pull them up. So, if you go in the book, there's a thing about train tracks. And there are three levels of train tracks. There's a railroad line, which is terrain dash, no cross check, flat, no bulletproof cover. So it's a flat track. That's kind of like you might see in a city or going towards a depot or something like that. Then there's the second kind, which is a low embankment. This is actually, you know, in America, this is probably what you would see out in like the rural. They build ditches on the sides to build up the tracks. That way, if it floods, the water's in the ditches, not on the track. Also, maybe keeps the cows out back in the day. Terrain dash. There's a cross check. It's short. And it provides bulletproof cover if you're up against it. Now, the one thing that people don't like is that if all of a sudden you have a terrain track going all the way across, it is a very huge terrain feature that provides concealment from everyone. And if your vehicles, you might not have enough crossing points, because the unofficial rule is to have three crossing points. So if you had three roads for crossing, it might be okay to play it that way. I should have specified train tracks. Yeah, we're talking about train tracks. And then there's the high embankment, which is like, you know, I don't know. I haven't seen too many high embankment train tracks. Yeah, it's impossible. Yeah, impossible, tall terrain. Yeah, your railroad line could be on those, like in a low embankment or something like that. So that's what that is. So I try to keep it flat. There's plenty of terrain out there on the board, keep it flat. I don't know, Malcolm, did that answer your question? All right. Hey, why you got, that's cool. Thanks for the info. Okay, cool. I hope I hit on it or walked away with something. Let's kind of, play, let's do our, what did we learn? You guys learn anything out there? She stepped away. Hey, Ray, did you learn anything? Ray, did you learn anything?
No.
No? Okay, good check. I'm glad that. We're playing What Did We Learn?
We're going to have a Panzerpest pen.
A Panzerpest pen.
Yes.
Yes. Right. That's what we're going to have. So there's that. By the way, if you have a subject that you want some in-depth talk about or go over and see how that applies to your game, email me or post it that you'd like to see a subject. In fact, that's how we did last subject about minefields. I'm more than happy to talk about it. Malcolm says here, I haven't played in a while and I never played Team Yankee version 2. So that was helpful. No problem. I've learned that Windows uses 5 centimeter rule. That's right. They do. That's 2 inches for us put a man on the moon. I'm just kidding about that. Well, I didn't kid about that. We did put a man on the moon, but yeah. So 2 inches is 5 centimeters. Matter of fact, I'll be honest. I didn't know that until I read that, and I said, "Wait, I need to read that again." Oh, I get it. Basically, he says, Phil's basically saying, "No, you know what? Treat that as a specialized wood, forest." I'm like, okay, cool. We'll do that. Rich learned that rerolls need line of sight to apply. I got busted on this when one commander was behind a high wall. Yeah. Actually, that's movement. Your movement really establishes your line of sight. Also, when you if you do an assault and you want your commander to help you through morale to stay in the fight, once again, you got to be careful about how you move. If you don't move the one IC with the fight and you move your commander, the platoon commander in, you got to be careful because you might put him somewhere in the thing where he blocks line of sight or moves out 6 inches, which you don't get any, get the reroll. All right. Did I learn anything today?
Did you learn anything today?
You know what? I learn something new every day and then try to make someone laugh. And that's how I know my day's complete.
Who'd you make laugh?
How do I make laugh?
Who did you make laugh?
I don't know. Everyone who's probably listening to me talk about these rules. And I know
it.
You
just made me laugh.
Oh, yeah. Spell hall, H-U-L-L. I put, as a banquet hall, H-L-L, H-A-L-L. Chris Grew learned that I learned there's such thing as a butcher thread. Yeah. I never knew. I actually worked for a butcher at one point. Malcolm says your cat made me laugh. Yeah, that cat's hilarious. Actually, it's a cool cat. Maybe in the live show, I'll tell the story about how we got the cat. There's a whole story about that silly cat. Of course there is. I can make anything to a story, By the way, you want to get ready and play us out?
Sure.
Let these good people go on with their lives?
Yep.
Yep.
You ready?
Am I ready?
I don't know. Are you born ready?
I am born ready. I'll talk through the song, too, because okay. I feel like it.
I'm going to play the other version.
Oh, you're playing the other version.
Yeah.
Oh, she...
Another cover.
Now, if you guys remember, Duran Duran was huge during the 80s.
Huge.
And so they actually got to do a James Bond.
James Bond
film. Yeah.
A kill. Actually,
when I was looking for the covers,
found
someone talking about breakdown of this song.
Oh.
Actually, how they broke down the song?
Yes.
Huh. Actually, I don't know if they can hear you from there. Hey, wait, we need to get more than one mic. Hey.
By Hellbound Hearts.
Yes. That's what we got here. Check them out. If you like this song, check them out. Also remember, we got the, the side tournament. And that Sunday we're doing a broadcast. You can be part of the live studio audience. You can have Ray will be out there. Oh, yeah. Ray's going to be holding that applause sign. It's done. Yeah, the applause sign. It's into the fire. Now, why would one dance into the fire? Or is that dumb? Or is that some type of, I don't want to say allegory. What am I thinking of? I like that. So I don't think Duran Duran did that. I don't know how we got out of the 80s. You know what I should do is I should... There I go. There's my 80s look. Turn the collar up. No, is it? Collar up is an 80s thing.
No, when did I meet you?
Oh,
93. But yes, they used to have the collars up. Actually, dressed
right up
that way once with a satin jacket.
Yeah. Yeah.
Collar up.
Yeah. No, we. Yeah, we met 93, which was, you know, the grunge. Matter of fact, come to think about it, I think I wore layers, and I had a t-shirt and
a denim shirt
over. I was so cool. Yeah, you know, the men wanted to be me, and the ladies wanted to be with me. Oh, is that it?
That's it.
All right, good night, everyone. See you next week.